Hi everyone, Coach Troy here, and today we're talking about the sliding filament theory with a twist. We're primarily talking about the foundation of this presentation, muscle contraction, and how it's going to 10x your results in the gym. So before we get going here, there's a couple of things I'm going to reference in this presentation. Number one is sarco, number two is myo. When we talk about sarco, that is Greek for muscle. When we talk about myo, that's Latin for muscle. So I might reference the sarcoplasmic reticulum, which is the endoplasmic reticulum for skeletal muscle. I might also say the sarcolemma, which is the plasma membrane of skeletal muscle. I might even say the sarcoplasm, which is the cytoplasm of skeletal muscle. Now, when it comes to myo, we've got a myocyte, and then we've got a myofibril, and then we've got myofilaments, which are the contractile proteins that allow for muscle contraction to occur. So what we're going to do today is talk about the gluteus maximus. Since it's one of the biggest muscle groups in the human body, you could even use another arbitrary muscle group, maybe the latissimus dorsi, maybe the bicep, maybe the pectorals. But for now, we're just going to talk about the gluteus maximus. And when we talk about the gluteus maximus, what we're going to do is take that muscle and transplant it right here as the whole muscle. Then we're going to break it down and talk about the fascicle. Then we're going to break it down again into what we call the muscle cell, aka myocyte or muscle fiber. Then we're going to go down even deeper and transplant it here, which is what we call the myofibril. And then last but not least, the sarcomere, which is the myofilaments, which are actin and myosin, which we'll talk about in a second. So when we look at an exercise like the CAS glute bridge, like the glute bridge, or even the hip thrust, we're looking at trying to get as much from the exercise as possible. Now, a lot of people, when they train, they focus primarily on the eccentric, lowering phase and the concentric phase, right, the positive phase, but they seem to miss out on a key piece, which is the muscle contraction, which is, if we look at the whole smallest subunit of the myofibril, which is the sarcomere, we need to understand that if we can get this to function better, we're going to definitely get better results in the gym. So when it comes to muscle shortening, right, when we're talking about the glute, maybe a CAS glute bridge in that top position when the glutes contract, or a bicep curl as an example, or a pec fly, that's muscle shortening. So what happens is the sarcomere binds and shortens, the myofibril shortens, the myocyte shortens, the fascicle shortens, the whole muscle shortens. And that is what we call the sliding filament theory, aka muscle contraction. So what does this mean to you in the gym? Well, let's say, for example, that you are doing an exercise like the CAS glute bridge. We need to understand the foundation of how this thing works. So let's take a look at this myofibril really, really quickly here. What I'm just going to reference here is the A band. Now, when you see the actin and myosin, they get this little sort of overlap right here. And you can look at this under a powerful microscope, and it will show that the actin and myosin, when they are in line with this A band right here, this is where there's overlap with the actin and myosin. And then this space here, which is called the I band, which is lighter, okay? So that we need to understand that also. And the reason why I've highlighted one Z disc to another Z disc is when the actin and myosin bind to each other and shorten, this is what we call muscle contraction. And this thing is the smallest unit of muscle contraction. We will blow this up and take a look at this in a little bit more detail later on. Now, in order for muscle contraction to occur, it needs to come from the brain, which is the motor cortex, and then it goes to the spinal cord, and then it goes to the muscle. Now, we call this an action potential, okay? So let's say this is the glute muscle here, and we want to get the glutes to fully shorten in a CAS glute bridge or a hip thrust. So what happens is this action potential, also we can talk about the neuromuscular junction. So when this lower motor neuron attaches to this muscle fiber, it does it through releasing sodium, but only until the neurotransmitter that's released, which I'll come on to in a second, needs to attach to the receptor on this muscle. Now, the receptor on this muscle is called nicotinic. There's two, there's muscarinic and nicotinic. But when this attaches, it releases acetylcholine. and acetylcholine will bind to acetylcholine receptor, nicotinic, on this muscle, and then sodium now moves in, which has a positive charge. Now, what happens, interestingly enough, is that sodium also just sort of penetrates the sort of inner layer of this plasma membrane here. But what we need to understand is sodium needs to go deep into the muscle. So what happens is it goes down this thing called T-tubules. And then once the sodium reaches the middle layer, which is the sarcoplasmic reticulum, this is where calcium ions specifically, is stored in the muscle cell. So once sodium is released, goes down T-tubules, it releases calcium. Calcium is one of the core drivers to allow muscle contraction to occur. So we're getting there, but there's one more key step, which I'll come on to a second. So we need to hold that in our vision right there. And then what we're going to do now is just blow this up and take a look at the sarcomere in greater detail. Okay, we've just blown up magically the sarcomere, which is the smallest subunit of the myofibril. And we're going to take a deeper look at how this thing works to help you get better results in the gym. Before I touch on that, I do want to mention something about the orange springy stuff that you see on the side here. This is actually, in fact, a large protein molecule. It's actually one of the largest protein molecules, and it's called chitin. And what it's responsible for is to hold the myosin in place from one Z disc to the next. So when contraction occurs, or a glute contraction occurs, the muscle can spring back, okay? So that's important. Chitin is an important protein molecule. Like I said, it's one of the largest ones. So when it comes to the sarcomere, okay, we've just spoken about how calcium comes into play, which is the first step. But let's digress on that a little bit more. Now, what you're going to find, let's use a blue pen here. Let's go over this. Let's just put this actin line here. What's interesting about the actin molecule, there is a chain that wraps around that actin. And what's interesting with the chain is there's a lock, okay? The chain is called triple myosin and the lock is called troponin. We need a key to open up the lock and to allow the triple myosin and the troponin to break away. What's the key? It's calcium. So let's get rid of that, right? Because now calcium's done its job. Let's get rid of the troponin. And now we're going to talk about step two in order for muscle contraction to occur, and that's ATP. So in order to do things, in order to work out, in order to move, we need energy, right? ATP, adenosine triphosphate. Now, Dr. Mike, who's an Australian biologist, does a phenomenal illustration of using his hand as the myosin head and then using his opposite hand, his forearm, as the actin molecule. So let's say ATP will join to the myosin head. ATP will then disassociate to ADP and phosphate. What happens now is the myosin head cocks and binds. ADP and phosphate will then disassociate and perform a power stroke, muscle shortening, glute contraction. However, the myosin head is stuck. What do we need more of? We need more ATP. ATP comes along, releases the myosin head, and now we're back at the start. Okay, so now we've explained about calcium and we've explained about how ATP and ADP and phosphate are the pre-fundamental functions to allow muscle contraction to occur. Let's talk about the Cas-glute bridge. Now, the Cas-glute bridge is a great exercise because it's more glute isolation, whereas the hip thrust, which allows you to use a little bit more load because you've got a little bit more quad activation, right? We're going to talk about the Cas-glute bridge. Now, when I'm coaching clients, what I will get them to do on their very last set, especially if the goal is to hypertrophy, I'm going to get them to do a 6 to 12 second isometric contraction, isometric hold. Oftentimes I'll round it off and I'll just do 10 seconds on that very first rep. Neurologically, that's priming the muscle for the next repetitions to come. So you really set yourself up for success. So you're getting that glute contraction, that top position on the CAS glute bridge. You're getting your navel to your sternum, which is going to flatten out the lumbar region, L1 to L5. And now you can get a really good glute contraction. You're going to squeeze and activate that for 10 seconds. And then on the second rep, on that last set, all of your reps onwards are going to be a 2-0-1-2. That's basically 5 seconds of repetition. You times that by 10 reps, that would be 50 seconds worth of time under tension. Scientifically proven, that is right in the sweet spot of hypertrophy, which is with load, working in between 40 and 70 seconds worth of tension. Now, I might make this even harder, depending on the level of the client. I might get them doing a 2-0-1-4 cadence. I highlighted a 4 just to represent the isometric contraction. So it would be 2 seconds eccentric, no pause, 0 at the bottom, 1 second concentric, and then a 4 second isometric glute contraction. That is what, 4, 6, 7 seconds of rep. Times that by 10, that's 70 seconds worth of tension. We are in that sweet spot again for hypertrophy. So my point is, before we wrap up, are you really taking advantage of the muscle contraction? Are you really utilizing it? You see, most people that I see over the last 3 decades of being in gyms all over the world, I tend to see most people focus on the concentric and eccentric phases, but they miss the most important piece. An example would be a cable crossover. They don't get that pec muscle to get fully shortened. Muscle contraction of the sarcomere, which is the smallest subunit of the myofibril. Would it be a good idea to start now introducing muscle contractions? Now, you might be thinking, that's a lot harder, coach. Absolutely, but isn't that the idea? The goal for you and I isn't to complete reps and sets. The goal for you and I is to challenge the muscle. And we do that by muscle contraction, holding them for a longer period of time. I hope this helps. This is the sliding filament theory with a twist, allowing you to get better results through using the muscle contraction theory in your training. Have a good day.